If a survey were to ask those of us who work in dermatology to name one part of our job which drives us crazy, iPledge would be near the top of the list. Dealing with iPledge can be one of the most frustrating aspects of our work, and for those who are new to dermatology, also one of the hardest to understand. In this module, we're going to review everything you really need to know about the iPledge program, what it is, why it was started, and how to navigate through the maze that it has now become. So first, let's answer the question, what is iPledge? The iPledge program has defined its goal as being to prevent pregnancies in patients taking isotretinoin and to prevent pregnant patients from taking isotretinoin. And just so you know, isotretinoin is the generic name for the active ingredient. Originally, Accutane was the only name brand. Therefore, some will still refer to isotretinoin as Accutane. Technically speaking, however, there are now quite a few brands available. So in order to fill any given prescription of isotretinoin, everyone involved, that is, the prescribers, the patients, and the pharmacy, must all participate in the iPledge program. In doing so, certain obligations must be fulfilled. And because fulfillment of these obligations can be time-consuming, guess who the dermatologist usually asks to perform the majority of the work involved with iPledge compliance? The answer, of course, is the nursing and medical assistant staff like you. So over the next few minutes, we're going to be reviewing in depth the steps necessary to navigate the iPledge system. Don't worry about committing all of these details to memory right now. Instead, just focus on the big picture of how it works. Once you understand the general principles of iPledge, then navigating through the various steps will make a lot more sense. First, let's talk about the reason why iPledge was implemented. Some of you may remember from the retinoids module that isotretinoin is a teratogen. That is, if it's taken during pregnancy, it can result in birth defects. And the fact that isotretinoin can cause birth defects directly affects how iPledge is implemented. Specifically, the rules and requirements of iPledge vary depending on the patient's ability to become pregnant. Now notice here that we're saying their ability to become pregnant. We're not saying their likelihood or probability of becoming pregnant. Instead, iPledge is focused on the theoretical ability of a patient being able to get pregnant. You'll see here in a moment why we need to emphasize this. But regardless of one's ability to become pregnant, there are certain rules which affect all patients. And they are, first, that every patient who is prescribed isotretinoin must participate in iPledge. Second, all patients and their parents, if a minor, must review and provide consent before starting isotretinoin. This consent is fairly extensive and leaves little room for patients to later claim that they were never told about any of the potential side effects associated with isotretinoin. So from a medical legal standpoint, this is actually a good requirement, as it also offers a degree of protection to the practice in which you work. Third, all patients who are on isotretinoin need to be seen monthly while on it, and treatment usually lasts for 5 or 6 months. This is significant for a few reasons. If an established patient has a history of repeated cancellations or no-shows, then some dermatologists will understandably refuse to prescribe isotretinoin to the patient, as it would be reasonable to believe that the patient may not be compliant with other iPledge requirements. Also, although it's not an absolute requirement, ideally, whoever starts the patient on isotretinoin should also be the one who cares for the patient throughout the course of their treatment. There are situations in which it's simply unavoidable, and patients will need to transfer care to another provider. But again, ideally, it's best for patients who need to get on isotretinoin to be settled in with plans to be around and available for monthly follow-ups as needed throughout the course of the treatment. And finally, the last universal rule affecting all patients is that they cannot be prescribed more than a 30-day supply of isotretinoin at one time. This is done to ensure that patients return monthly for reevaluation, so those who use mail-order pharmacies and are looking for a 90-day supply of medicine are out of luck. So these are the rules which affect everyone. Additional rules apply, but those rules vary depending on the category to which the patient is assigned. And in iPledge, there are two categories. The first being that of patients who can become pregnant, and the second being that of patients who cannot become pregnant. Sounds pretty straightforward, right? Overall, it is, but it can get a little tricky. But before we explain what we mean, we need to first provide a few definitions for those of you who may not be familiar. And those definitions are for the words cisgender and transgender. The term cisgender refers to those patients whose gender identity matches the sex assigned to them at birth. Transgender is used to describe someone who identifies as a gender which is different than the sex assigned to them at birth. And the reason it's important to understand this is because the iPledge program uses these terms in their program materials. For example, here we see both being used on the chart which provides us with the two iPledge patient categories, which again are that of patients who can become pregnant and patients who cannot become pregnant. So let's start with the easier of the two categories, which is that of patients who cannot become pregnant. As we can see here, the descriptions provided by iPledge can get lengthy, even more so due to their gender-neutral terminology. So if you find the terms cisgender and transgender to be confusing, just consider, was the patient born a biological female? If the answer is no, then no more investigating is needed. You have your answer. Patients who were born biologically as a male cannot get pregnant, and they belong in this category. But what if they were born as a biological female? If so, then the question would be, does the patient have a functioning uterus and at least one ovary? If the answer again is no, then they also belong to this group. So just to be clear, in order to qualify as a patient who cannot become pregnant, the patient must have been born as a biological male, or if they were born as a biological female, then they must have either had a hysterectomy or are postmenopausal or have had both ovaries removed. If this criteria does not apply to the patient, then they will be considered a patient who can become pregnant. Overall, this classification system makes sense, but there are some things about it which you may find surprising. First, per iPledge, tubal ligation alone does not qualify the patient as cannot become pregnant. If they still have a uterus and at least one ovary, and they're not postmenopausal, then they'll be classified as a patient who can become pregnant. Per iPledge, abstinence does not qualify the patient as cannot become pregnant. Again, iPledge is focused on the theoretical ability to become pregnant. Although an individual may choose abstinence, they theoretically could become pregnant, even if we all know that they will never become pregnant as long as they're abstinent. And finally, it's worth mentioning that looking like a man does not qualify the patient as cannot become pregnant. To those who are new to working in medicine, this may sound like a joke, but it's not. In the clinic, you will eventually meet some patients who you assume were born male, but were in fact born female. This is especially true since testosterone therapies are more widely available for trans men. Again, if they have a uterus and at least one functioning ovary, then they'll be classified as a patient who can become pregnant. So let's take a look at this visual, which provides an overview of the process. First, all patients who are prescribed isotretinoin must participate in the iPledge program. And second, we must determine the patient's classification. Are they a patient who cannot become pregnant, or are they a patient who can become pregnant? Once you've determined the patient's classification, it's then simply a matter of understanding the steps necessary to register the patient, confirm them at each monthly visit, and then finish their treatment and discontinue them from iPledge. It's these processes of registering, confirming, and discontinuing patients from iPledge that vary significantly for each of these two groups. So let's start with registration. For patients who cannot become pregnant, the first step is to have a brief talk about the general requirements of iPledge. A good starting point is to let them know about the expected 5 to 6 months of treatment, during which they'll need to follow up every month. Also, most doctors will want some monitoring labs performed, at least in the beginning, if not every month. The reason that these are important to discuss right off the bat is because it's surprising how many patients abandon their requests once they hear about these requirements. For example, you tell the patient about the need to come in every month, but then they admit that they'll be traveling soon, and maybe it would be better to start off after they're settled back in. Or they're only going to be here for another few weeks, because then they go off to college in another state, in which case they'd probably be better off getting set up in iPledge with a dermatologist near their college. And perhaps one of the more surprising disqualifiers is this, the need for labs. Sometimes patients will come in with horrible acne, and they clearly qualify for treatment, but then they hear about the need for blood to be drawn, and they instantly decide to not pursue treatment. Some patients are just that afraid of needles. So trust us, it's not fun to spend 20 minutes talking to patients about iPledge, only to have them decide against it for these types of reasons, which had they known early on, they'd have immediately admitted that perhaps now isn't a good time to start. That's why it's recommended to incorporate a quick iPledge overview talk early on with any patient who is considering it. So once you know that they are overall able and willing to proceed, then comes the fun part of talking about potential side effects. Isotretinoin as a medication is reviewed elsewhere in our medications modules, so we'll avoid an in-depth discussion here. As with any medicine, though, there is a potential for side effects. The most common side effects are minor. At therapeutic levels, isotretinoin essentially puts the oil glands into hibernation, with such a drastic shutdown of our skin's natural oil production. Dry skin and chapped lips are a very common issue, as are dry eyes. Cholesterol and triglycerides also tend to increase while patients are on it. But these are relatively minor, if not asymptomatic, issues. What's really important to discuss, though, is the potential for a few more serious side effects. Among the most notorious for isotretinoin are depression, suicidal ideation, Crohn's disease, and ulcerative colitis. Again, we're not going to get into an in-depth discussion here, but as those of you who have worked in dermatology for a while know, most dermatologists take the time to explain to patients that these side effects are really debatable. In fact, the term potential association is really more appropriate when it comes to describing these side effects. That is, there have been reports of a potential association of isotretinoin with these side effects, but nothing conclusive. If anything, a number of studies have actually found the exact opposite, at least with respect to depression and suicidal ideation, as would make sense. In other words, acne itself is depressing, and when we clear it up, patients tend to have a brighter outlook on life. But in any case, you'd want to let your supervising physician know if a patient requesting isotretinoin has either a personal or a strong family history of any of these. Now, just to be clear, discussion of these potential side effects is ultimately the responsibility of the provider. But as their assistant, you do need to have at least an idea of what side effects are most concerning to the patients. A moment ago, we mentioned labs. It's worth noting that, although it's common practice, the monitoring of CBC, lipids, and hepatic function is technically not a component of iPledge. That may come as a surprise to some of you watching this. iPledge has nothing to do with monitoring a patient's CBC, lipids, or hepatic function. This is not in any way meant to detract from the importance of monitoring the patient's blood work, but the point is that we just need to remember that iPledge itself is focused on the pregnancy prevention aspect of isotretinoin use. Exactly when, which, and how often monitoring labs are checked is entirely up to the preferences of the supervising physician. Many will check labs at baseline and monthly thereafter, but some don't. Again, defer to the protocol within your office. Alright, so once it's determined that the patient will be proceeding with treatment, someone is going to need to log on to iPledge. Now, this is a little bit tricky of a situation, so please listen carefully. Officially, iPledge asks that whoever logs into iPledge should do so under their own credentials. For this reason, there are three types of accounts available within iPledge, at least with respect to those of us in the clinic. They are, first, the prescriber accounts, which of course would be the doc, PA, or NP. Those same individuals can also be considered a delegate. By that we mean that they can act on behalf of another prescriber. For example, let's say that there's a clinic owner who's a doctor, but they also have some PAs and NPs working for them. So it wouldn't be uncommon for those PAs and NPs to be considered delegates of the doc who owns the practice. And in doing so, they're then able to manage patients under that doctor's account. Designee, on the other hand, is the category where most of you watching this video would fall into. That is, designees are typically like the nurse, MA, or derm tech who assists the doc, PA, or NP. But again, this is where it gets tricky. Whereas we're all technically supposed to only log in under our own username and password, unofficially, in some clinics, logging in under iPledge is a community effort. As with pretty much everything we do in the clinic, it's all about balance. Officially, we need to follow the rules. But unofficially, there's no escaping the fact that working in the clinic is a team effort, and we'll just leave it at that. When everything is said and done, discuss the login protocol of your office with your coworkers and supervising physicians. All right, so once we're logged in, we see the option to enroll a new patient. And the very first option we need to choose is the classification of the patient. That is, are they a patient who can become pregnant, or are they a patient who cannot become pregnant? Well, right now we're discussing the process for the easier of the two, which are patients who cannot become pregnant. But notice how even after we provide the patient classification, we're again asked to confirm our understanding as iPledge walks us through the criteria. So we then enter the patient's information, being sure to include their phone number and email, and then comes the official consent. Whereas in the past, we traditionally used paper booklets and consents, the process now is just about entirely online. So yes, you can print out a paper consent and have the patient and or their parents sign that and confirm that you have that on file. But generally speaking, most of the time nowadays, we're going to be choosing this option of having the patient complete and sign the consent electronically. And the patient, along with their parent, if they're a minor, will review and sign the consent right then and there. In many clinics, this is done on the clinic iPad, or of course, they can simply walk over to the computer if your clinic doesn't use tablets. Once they sign the consent, the prescriber, him or herself, needs to sign off on the registration, again confirming that they understand the requirements and everything has been explained to the patient. So once the registration and consent process that we just saw has been completed, then isotretinoin can be prescribed. Again, just a reminder, we're currently talking about cannot get pregnant patients. As previously mentioned, those who are classified as cannot get pregnant patients are much easier to register, and their overall course of treatment is simply more straightforward. Really, the only remaining requirement is that in order to pick up the prescription at the pharmacy itself will need to have the patient's iPledge number. You may recall how during the registration process, we were asked to enter the patient's email or phone number. As part of the process, iPledge will send the patient additional links and information, which include a QR code that they can keep on their phone, and that QR code can then be shown to the pharmacist. All right, so now let's talk about the other group, the slightly more complicated group of patients who can get pregnant. The process actually starts in a similar fashion in that we should always start with a brief overview. Again, you will come across patients who initially express interest, but then after hearing about the expected 5 to 6 months of treatment, the need for monthly follow-up, labs, and potential side effects, they just decide to either not pursue it at all, or they at least decide to take some time to think about it. A major difference, though, as compared to the first group, is that patients who are placed in the can get pregnant category have additional requirements. And among those requirements are, first, proving that the patient isn't currently pregnant and that steps will be taken to avoid any potential pregnancies within 1 month prior, during, and 1 month after treatment. Sexually active patients must agree to using two forms of birth control, again, for at least 1 month before, during, and 1 month after treatment. We could actually get into a whole other discussion about birth control requirements of iPledge, but we'll instead refer you to the iPledge learning material to better understand these requirements for yourself. Part of the reason we're not going to get into a lengthy discussion here is because, for some, the requirements border on the ridiculous. For example, a 45-year-old premenopausal woman who has had her tubes tied, if she still has her uterus and ovaries, and she's technically not yet postmenopausal, then per iPledge, she's obligated to agree to use a second form of birth control during sexual activity. Women who are in a monogamous relationship with their husband, but their husband has had a vasectomy, same thing. They're supposed to agree to use a secondary form of birth control as well. Again, we're not going to get into that discussion, but just understand and make sure the patient understands that if they want to play the iPledge game, then they're going to have to play by the iPledge rules. The good news for many, though, is that abstinence is an option. Just to be clear, the sexual activity which concerns iPledge is that which can cause pregnancy. So abstinence in this context doesn't necessarily mean sex in general, but instead it's specifically referring to any sexual contact with a partner that could result in pregnancy. Everyone watching this should be an adult, so we're not going to provide detailed explanations, but suffice it to say that pregnancy can only happen if specific anatomy and fluids are involved. So as long as any given patient agrees to avoid sexual activity which could result in pregnancy, they can claim abstinence. So here's where all of this gets really important for us during the registration process. iPledge requires that before any new enrollees who are classified as can get pregnant can start the medication, they must wait at least 30 days after their baseline negative HCG has been performed. It doesn't matter if the patient is abstinent, has had her tubes tied, etc. If the patient is classified as can get pregnant, then they will need to have pregnancy testing performed. But here's where it's really, really important for us to pay attention. The clock on this 30-day waiting period only starts ticking once the patient has been registered and their negative HCG results have been documented. So let's take a look at the registration process, and you'll see how important this step really is. The initial process starts off about the same as the registration of patients who cannot get pregnant, in which we first need to categorize the patient, and then once we indicate that we're trying to register a patient who can become pregnant, the very first item that it asks us to confirm is their pregnancy test results. Now notice something, you cannot proceed with registration of this patient into iPledge without first completing this step. However, as an assistant in the clinic, at some point you will encounter a scenario in which patients have shown up late, you're short-staffed, and you and the docs are doing everything you can just to keep your heads above water. Then imagine that on top of that, you and the doc just spent 25 minutes talking to this patient about iPledge, answering her questions, as well as the mother's, and you're essentially done with the visit, except that you all just need to perform the baseline HCG. In hectic scenarios like this, which really aren't that uncommon, there are times in which it's tempting to just perform the HCG, and then you all decide to finish the registration once those results come back in. But here's the deal. If for any reason someone there in the clinic forgets to document the negative pregnancy test, and in turn, never officially completes the patient's registration, then the 30-day waiting period will have never started. When this happens, patients will show up a month later, thinking that they're about to start isotretinoin, but can't. Instead, you all are going to have the patient draw another HCG, and the patient will again need to wait another 30 days before they can start. At least in the world of dermatology, this is about as good a way of ruining someone's day as it gets. Patients in this situation understandably get angry, and then that anger is taken out on the doc, who very well may then take it out on you as their assistant, whose job it was a month ago to make sure that the patient was registered and everything was documented correctly. Again, we're not talking about fixing a simple mistake in the computer, but then carrying on with the visit. Instead, we're talking about this patient waiting an entire additional month before they can start. And when you're dealing with someone who is battling severe acne, every day can seem like an eternity. This doesn't really come down to who's right and who's wrong, because the truth is that the doc is ultimately responsible. But in a practical sense, trust us when we say that you, as their assistant, are often going to take the blame, if and when this occurs. So please, don't let this happen. Either now, during their initial registration process, or later, during the monthly follow-ups, always be sure that everything gets documented as it's supposed to get documented. Okay, let's come back to where we left off and assume that you are documenting everything as needed and completing the registration process correctly. Similar to the other registration, we fill in their information and then we're going to say that we want to complete their consent online. Then they and possibly their parent review and sign their part, which will now include this section about pregnancy avoidance. And this brings up a good example of why we want to incorporate these into our initial discussions with the patient. That is, if and when you get the sense that a patient is likely to start isotretinoin and they belong to the can get pregnant category, you'll want to have touched on all of these points already, including how iPledge defines abstinence, sexual activity, etc. What you don't want is to reach this point of the visit where the patient has your clinic's iPad in their hands to sign off on everything, but then they want to hit the brakes and talk about all of these requirements for the next 20 minutes before they sign off. You can do it that way, but it's just not ideal. Instead, by the time patients reach this stage, they really should have already been made aware of how iPledge works, including the various definitions and requirements. Now, here we get a little bit of insight into the monitoring and follow-up process while they're on iPledge, in that they spell out how all patients classified as can get pregnant will need two pregnancy tests before they can begin treatment. The first one is typically performed right about now, when you're initially registering the patient. The second pregnancy test will need to be at least 30 days after the first, and it's the one which presumably will be performed when they return next month to begin treatment, after they've waited out the 30-day lockout. Now, you may have seen here and there throughout the course that we tend to interject some real talk into the discussions. And so here we're faced with another, which has to do with what we see here. Officially speaking, the second baseline HCG, the one which is performed to allow the patient to begin isotretinoin therapy, it's officially supposed to be performed both at least 30 days after the first and within the first 5 days of the patient's next menstrual cycle. So what this means is that, again, officially speaking, if the patient is here today to get registered in iPledge, they're going to get their first baseline HCG performed today. But let's say that their last menstrual cycle ended 2 weeks ago. According to iPledge rules, they're officially not supposed to have their second pregnancy test performed until at least another month has passed and they're within the first 5 days of their next cycle. Which, if we're doing the math right, would have that patient officially needing to wait until at least another 5 or 6 weeks from now before they can come back to get their second baseline HCG done and begin treatment. However, many patients do not want to wait longer than 30 days after registration to begin treatment. They're ready to begin as soon as possible. So iPledge does state that for patients with amenorrhea, irregular cycles, or those using a contraceptive form that precludes withdrawal bleeding, their second pregnancy test can be done as soon as 30 days after the first. Okay, picking up where we left off, patients will complete and sign the remaining consent, and then we, or more specifically, the provider adds their confirmation and consent, and the patient is registered. So now that the can-get-pregnant patient is registered, the follow-up visit, the one which is intended for getting the patient started on isotretinoin, needs to be scheduled accordingly. And there are two important factors to consider. First, the timing. As we just reviewed, iPledge has rules the patient must follow. So far as timing, the next visit will need to be at least 30 days later, possibly longer if following the first 5 days of menstrual cycle rule is applied. But then what about labs? Again, other labs such as CBC, hepatic function, and lipids are technically unrelated to iPledge. Instead, iPledge is focused on the pregnancy testing. So will the patient have their HCG performed in the clinic or at an outside lab? If at an outside lab, do they need a lab slip? And whether that test is performed at an outside lab or right there in your clinic, the patient must wait at least 30 days before that second test is performed. We are again going to get serious here because this is important. You remember this scenario from a few slides back? 30 days is a recurring theme throughout iPledge. A minimum of 30 days must pass between routine follow-up visits for both can and cannot patients. But also, a minimum of 30 days must pass between each of the routine pregnancy tests we perform for patients in the can-get-pregnant category. What does this mean? Well, consider the following scenario. The doc is angry because the patient was seen last month, but at least by the calendar, only 28 days have passed. To make matters worse, the patient had to take time off of work and spend an hour in traffic just to get here. She's even had her pregnancy test performed already, but now we have to tell her that she came back too soon. Some of you who have been working in derm for a while have already experienced this scenario more than once, and it's not fun. The point is that when iPledge says at least 30 days, they don't mean next month or 4 weeks. They mean at least 30 days. Because of this, all of us should be careful to actually use that wording, at least 30 days, when it comes to telling the front desk and checkout about their next appointment. And those working at checkout need to understand the significance of that wording when it's indicated. So once the can-get-pregnant patient has been registered, with their baseline HCG documented, of course, and at least 30 days has passed, they will return to the clinic for what will be the first visit in which they can actually be prescribed isotretinoin. A repeat HCG is needed, and then we need to log on to iPledge and document the patient counseling, contraceptive methods, and their pregnancy test results. Now, a few things here. Notice that if we choose abstinence, that it again provides the definition of abstinence for us, but then also it blocks out secondary methods. This is one of the few times that iPledge actually makes sense, in that if someone is truly abstinent, then of course there's no need for a secondary method. But let's say the patient is sexually active, and we do enter their two methods. It's best to be consistent here. In other words, if at the start of the process, we describe to the patient's two methods as first, their tubes are tied, then second, they're on birth control pills, then just know that this is generally how it should be documented throughout the course of their treatment. If we change these, then sometimes iPledge will kick back an error message depending on the changes made. So again, try to be consistent here with both the methods chosen and the order that they're placed in. And then we need to document their latest pregnancy test results. Notice that when we confirm pregnancy testing, it's not a simple yes or no answer. We need to enter the type of pregnancy test performed, as well as the date. We confirm the patient isn't pregnant, and then, and only then, can this patient begin isotretinoin therapy. Even though we're done with our part, they still have to do their part, which involves logging onto the iPledge website and confirming their understanding of the iPledge rules and requirements, particularly those which have to do with pregnancy avoidance. Now, it's worth noting that the patient will not be able to log on to iPledge themselves and do their part until we've done ours. Imagine a patient was seen earlier in the day. You all sent in their prescription, but now they're calling the office because they've not yet been able to log on themselves and provide confirmation of their understanding. Then someone looks into the computer and again makes this face. Why? Because whoever was helping you earlier to confirm the patient in iPledge forgot to hit save and officially submit all of the details. Relative to other issues that can happen, this one isn't a big deal, but more than anything, it's just annoying for the patient. So just remember, when you enter details in iPledge, the process isn't complete until you hit save. And similar to the other group of patients, those who cannot get pregnant, the pharmacy will also need these patients' iPledge number in order to dispense the prescription. Fortunately, once patients are on isotretinoin, the process is much more streamlined. So let's talk about monthly follow-ups. Every month, patients who cannot get pregnant will need to have lab work performed if any has been ordered. Just as a reminder, these technically aren't a requirement of iPledge. Many docs order them, but not all do, or those that do may not necessarily have them drawn every month. So at least with respect to patients who cannot get pregnant, the labs as well as the timing of those labs will vary depending on your particular practice's protocol. And then patients need to be seen. In other words, we can't just call in refills for iPledge patients. Virtual or telemedicine visits can be performed if otherwise allowed by your state or insurance regulations. But regardless of whether the patient is seen in person or in a telederm visit, remember the 30-day rule? It applies here as well. That is, follow-up visits for those on isotretinoin cannot be scheduled sooner than at least 30 days after the prior visit. Until at least 30 days has passed, iPledge won't even allow us to confirm the patient counseling. So assuming everything is in order, confirming these patients is easy. We just log on to iPledge, click their name, confirm that we've counseled them regarding iPledge, hit save, and we're done. We can now send their prescription to the pharmacy. And similar to their first prescription after being registered, patients will need to provide the pharmacy with their iPledge number, or they can present the QR code. Again, for cannot become pregnant patients, it's pretty straightforward once they're up and going with an iPledge. For patients who can get pregnant, overall, yes, most of the hard work has already been done, as registering these patients and getting them their first prescription is definitely the most difficult part. But still, there are some steps which need to be carefully followed each month, or it can cause problems. First, they too will need to have any labs performed that the doc has ordered. Again, if CBC, lipids, hepatic, or any others are ordered, that just depends on your practice's protocol. But HCG, that's what iPledge cares about. And just like that second confirmatory HCG, these monthly pregnancy tests must be performed at least 30 days after the prior visit. Remember this? Same thing. If the patient was last confirmed 27, 28, or 29 days ago, but they're here today, guess what? They came back too soon and we can't confirm them. So assuming it has been at least 30 days since both the prior HCG and visit, then the patient can be seen for follow-up. And the process is similar to the first. That is, we confirm patient counseling, document contraceptive methods, and their pregnancy test results. And just a reminder that one of the differences between can and cannot get pregnant patients is that can get pregnant patients will always need to log on to iPledge and confirm their understanding each month after we've seen them for their visit, but before they pick up their prescription. And again, they can't do this until we've done our part. So always be sure to have completed the process before the patient heads over to the pharmacy, or else you'll leave the patient hanging. And as always, the patient or their parent will want to bring their iPledge number or that QR code with them in order to receive their medicine. Now, it's worth mentioning something which is super important, which we need to understand as well as our patients. Notice what it says here in the rules. Patients who are classified as can get pregnant have up to 7 days to fill their prescription, and the clock starts ticking on the date that their pregnancy test for that prescription period has been drawn. If the patient does not fill their prescription within this 7-day window, it messes everything up. Just how bad it messes things up depends on a variety of factors, but at the very least, the patient would need to have a repeat pregnancy test drawn. At worst, though, the patient will have no choice but to wait for weeks until they can receive another prescription. So it's this 30-day routine that both we as well as the patient need to understand and follow. That is, the patient is seen, we document their pregnancy test results, and a new prescription is sent in. After we send in their prescription, they have a maximum of 7 days to pick it up from the pharmacy. Then after at least 30 days has passed since their last visit and HCG, the process repeats itself. Now, just a quick note about this 30-day rule before we go on. It's entirely okay for iPledge patients to follow up a little longer than 30 days later. It's never okay for iPledge patients to follow up a little before 30 days later. If the patient comes in prior to 30 days, we just flat out cannot even log on to iPledge and enter their information. So we generally want to err on the side of them coming back 31, 32, or even 35 days later, which is entirely okay. For patients who are concerned about any breaks in their treatment, they need to know that after isotretinoin has been in their system for at least a week, the momentum has started. So if, for scheduling reasons, they find themselves without medicine for a few days, reassure them that it's like a train that's already built momentum and is moving along. Going a few days without it is like taking our foot off the gas. The momentum will carry them through any short breaks, and they're going to be entirely okay. So again, following up a little longer than 30 days is entirely okay. Following up a little before 30 days is never okay. All right, so let's talk about discontinuing patients after they've successfully completed their course of treatment. As previously mentioned, most patients are on isotretinoin for about 5 or 6 months. Generally speaking, the only time a shorter course of treatment would occur would be if side effects or some other issues force them to discontinue treatment. Treatments longer than 5 or 6 months really aren't that uncommon, though, especially if the patient has been prescribed a relatively low dose. But again, on average, 5 or 6 months is about how long the majority of patients are on it. Now, this isn't part of iPledge itself, but just know that prescribers are generally aiming for the patient to have reached a certain total or cumulative dose of isotretinoin, which is to say the total amount of isotretinoin that they've taken per kilogram of their body weight. And it's this total dose that typically influences the duration of treatment. However, or whenever it's determined that the patient will be discontinuing isotretinoin, we need to tell iPledge. Now, you may have noticed that on prior screenshots of monthly confirmations that there is an option for us to check this box if this is the patient's last month of treatment. However, you may want to speak to the docs there, as well as your coworkers, to see if that's how they really want to do it. The reason is because we have to ask what will happen if the patient comes in next month for what we thought was going to be their end of treatment visit, but we see that they're still not quite clear yet, and we decide to extend them for another month. If we've already told iPledge that they're done, then this can cause problems. Alternatively, we can simply wait until we know that they'll be stopping, and then select this option to discontinue the patient. We enter the date and then the reason, which will typically be that the patient has completed the course of therapy. So if we cannot get pregnant patients, once we discontinue them in iPledge, they're done. They should still avoid donating blood for another month, just in case the person receiving the blood were to be pregnant. For patients who can get pregnant, in order to remain in compliance with iPledge, a few steps should still be followed. As we see here, they do need to have a pregnancy test performed right after they're done. Typically, the monthly HCG that they're having performed at every visit will count. However, notice the wording after the last dose. So if the patient still has some unused medicine left at home, they're either going to have to dispose of it, or they'll need to have another pregnancy test performed after they're done taking any remaining medicine that they have left at home. And then can-get pregnant patients are advised to continue their methods of contraception for an additional month after their last dose, and they should avoid donating blood for at least another month after their last dose. Now, this part is the one which is easily forgotten by both patients and provider, and therefore the one which can get iPledge upset. iPledge wants us to document a final pregnancy test, which is performed 30 days later, which again, just to be clear, should be 30 days after the patient has completely stopped taking the medicine. You can imagine that some patients at this point are tired of all the testing and they think they're finished anyway. So non-compliance with this step can be a problem, but it's important. If the patient is non-compliant and doesn't have this final pregnancy test performed, iPledge is going to let us know with an action required warning like we see here. And if we have patients who are non-compliant and we don't ourselves formally document that these patients have been lost to follow-up, then iPledge can suspend the prescriber's account. So again, we hope patients are compliant and have that final pregnancy test performed, and we need to document those results. But if they don't, then at the very least, we need to let iPledge know that the patient has been lost to follow-up. Doing so lets iPledge know that we did try, but it was the patient who was non-compliant and not us. And finally, there are a number of random scenarios which do occasionally arise with these patients. For example, what if a patient started iPledge somewhere else, but now they need to transfer to your supervising physician? What if a patient gets kicked out of iPledge, but then needs to be reinstated? What if a patient loses their login information? Your supervising physician and coworkers are almost certainly aware of how to handle these occasional, random situations. But when in doubt, just take the time to review the iPledge website yourself, or you can even try giving them a call. So with that, we conclude this lesson on iPledge. Hopefully this lesson has provided you with the explanations and resources needed to help you make sense of what can be a confusing and complicated program.